Okay, so let's go through these problems. The first one is this one. So a ray of white light traveling through fused quartz is incident at quartz air interface at angle theta 1. So the angle of refraction here is higher in the quartz than in air. So you may have total internal reflection. And this is what we have to be careful about in this problem. So if theta equal A, B or C, is the refracted light white, white dominated by red, and of the visible range, so mostly red or white but mostly blue? Or is there no refracted light? So yeah, we will have to be careful of the total internal reflection. So let's look. So we have to find out the critical angle first. So critical angle is given by this. So n of the air is 1, so it will be 1 divided by n of the quartz. So next, because the index in general, so in this yes, the index increases from red to blue. We just need to look at what is this critical angle for the two extremes, for red and blue. And they give the index for blue here and the index for red. So we calculate the two critical angles. For red light we get 43.38 degrees, and for blue light we get 42.86 degrees. So let's now look at the first case. So 42 degrees. So 42 degrees is lower than both, so it means there will be no total internal reflection within the visible range. So all the wavelengths of the visible range will be refracted, therefore transmitted in air, and therefore you will have a refracted light, white, will be white. So now let's go to the next one, 33.1. So now you see that it is in between these two values. So this 33.1 is lower than the value for the red. Therefore the red will still be transmitted. But the blue, so it is higher than the value for blue, so blue will be fully reflected, internally reflected. Therefore your transmitted light will be will have some red in it but no blue, so it will be mostly red. Okay, so theta 1 equals 44, so now we are above both values, so everything will be totally reflected inside the incident material. Therefore there will be no refracted light. Okay, so second question is about images. So you have here a convex mirror, and you know that you know P, 22 centimeters. So try to make a drawing that is roughly to scale. So if it is at 22, let's say 20, so you have 10 here, 0 here. And you can put some ticks at 10, 20, 30, 45. Your f is equal to 35 here. Okay, that's it, but they don't give you the sign. So find A, the radius of curvature, including sign. So now you know that it is a convex mirror, therefore by convention the radius is negative. And therefore, because r equal to f, f will also be negative. And so f equal 45, so your radius will be 70. centimeter. B, the image I, including sine. So you use the PIF formula and you find your I. So then you just fill in the values with appropriate signs. So P positive, F negative, you get minus 13.5 centimeters. So it would be roughly in between 10 and 20 here, somewhere here, closer to the 10. Okay. And you can check that with a ray diagram. So you take a ray parallel to central axis. You know it will be reflected such that it intersects F here. Okay. Then you can take the contrary. You take a ray that will intersect that F point, and it should be reflected parallel to the central axis. And then you continue that virtual ray, and you find indeed that the intersection is here, which is roughly between 10 and 20. So it makes sense. C, the lateral magnification. So m equal minus I divided by p. So again, you plug in the numbers. I is negative, so you will have a positive magnification of 0.61. So again, you check that indeed this object is erect, the image is erect also, and a smaller, roughly half of the object. D, real and or virtual. So here it intersects virtual rays, so it should be virtual. You can check it also with the numbers, because I is negative, therefore it is virtual image. Okay, E inverted from object to or non-inverted. From the drawing we see that it is non-inverted. We can also check it using the formulas. M is positive, therefore non-inverted. F on the same side of the mirror as O, or on the opposite side. So this is kind of you have to know where it is on the opposite side, because it is virtual. Okay, usually real images will be on the same side as the object in this case, and virtual on the opposite side. Okay. And G, draw a simple red diagram. Okay, we've done it. Okay, next question. We have two lenses here. This is, in fact, a beam expander. So this is a tool that you can find in optical systems. It is just to expand the beam. So let's say you have an incident beam with a width WI, and you want it to be larger, for example, to expand that beam. So you want it to be to have a width of WF final. Okay, so one way is to indeed use two lenses like this. So this is so F1 for lens 1, F2 for lens 2, and we make the two points coincide here at the same point. Right, so if you follow one ray, it will therefore, this is parallel to central axis, it will intersect the focal point, and because it also intersects the focal point of this lens, it will emerge parallel to the central axis. And same story for this one. Okay, so they give you a lot of things. They give you this width and the intensity. Intensity is so in a power per square meter. Okay. Enter the beam, etc. They give you F1 and F2. So what is WF? So here you see that what links WI and WF is pure geometry. You see that these two, for example, this triangle and this triangle are similar, and these angles are the same. So taking angle alpha, you can take the tangent, because you know this and you know that distance also. So tangent alpha will be WI divided by 2. And divided by this length, which is F1. And same story here, for this angle it will be WF divided by 2 divided by F2. Okay, so from this you get WF. Okay, because you know F1, F2 and WI. So you get in the end 6 mm. Okay, 2. B. What is the intensity IF of the beam leaving the beam expander? So here. So here you have a conservation of power. But because the area changes, you will change your intensity. Because the power is equal to the intensity by the area. Okay. So if the area changes, your intensity will change because your power is conserved. So the power, so this is a lens. So it is it has a spherical symmetry, circular symmetry at least, along the central axis. So the area of this beam is pi r squared, so it's pi w divided by 2 squared, so it is pi over 4 w squared. Okay. So we say pi I equal, so the power incident is equal to the power final here. Therefore, we can equal intensity initial by A initial, which is this, equals intensity final multiplied by this area final. So the pi over 4 will disappear, and you just get this equation. And from that, you can get I final equal I initial and the ratio of the two width squared. So running the calculation, you find 1.56 kilowatt per square meter, which makes sense that it has become smaller than the initial because you have increased the area. See what the value of d. D is the distance between the two lengths for the beam expander needed for the beam expander if lens 1, so this one, is replaced by a diverging lens of focal length f1 equal minus 26 centimeters. Alright, so here what you have to find out is that if you want a parallel beam, it's your incident beam is parallel. If you want your final beam to also be parallel, like this, you still need the two focal lengths be the same. Okay, so let's see that with the drawing. So the two focal points must still be the same. So let's see that. Okay, so now you have first a converging lens. So you have your parallel beam coming like that. So it will be it is a diverging lens. So your ray will diverge like this. And they intersect the focal point of that diverging lens. Okay, and this is F1. So, and after that, you want a parallel beam here. Your final beam must be parallel also. Therefore, you know that if you have a parallel beam here, your ray intersects the focal point of that converging lens. Okay? And because these rays already intersect the focal points of the diverging lens, therefore the two focal points must be at the same place. Right. So you just construct it in this way. So you know that you know F1 and F2. Therefore, in this case, D will be just F2 minus F1 in absolute value. Therefore, 4 centimeters. Okay. So now interference. So this is a common problem. We have air, a thin film of index N2, and air again, a soap film. They give you L and N2, white light, perpendicular as usual. We consider the reflection. For what wavelengths in the 300 to 700 range, nanometer range, is there fully constructive interference and B fully destructive interference? So this is a quite standard problem. We have to find out what are the phase shifts for the rays, and ultimately find the phase shift between ray 2 and ray 1. So for ray 1 is just reflecting. So we have to find out the phase shift for ray 1 from just after reflection compared to just before reflection. So we have to find out whether or not there is a phase shift of pi upon reflection. And there is, because n2 is greater than n of r. So there is a phase shift of pi. There is no phase shift related to the optical path difference because they just reflect, so there is no phi related to any length. So the total phase shift upon reflection for ray 1 is pi. Now for ray 2, so ray 2, just before it enters the material, to just after it leaves the material. So, okay, it travels 2L for the material, so you will have a phase shift related to the optical path, which is 2 pi over lambda multiplied by the optical path, which is N2 multiplied by 2L. And here we have a reflection. Do we have a phase shift upon reflection from N2 to R? No, because R is faster. Therefore, we do not have any phase shift related to reflection in this case. So phi 2 is just the contribution of the optical path difference. So now the total phase shift is phi 2 minus f2, f1, phi 1, which is this. So we have constructive interference if phi equal m2 pi, m element of z, or if the optical path related to that is equal to m lambda. So we do that. The optical path here is 2 times n2l, so this, 2 times n2l, minus, this is like lambda divided by 2, so minus lambda divided by 2, equal m lambda. Okay, and you take away, you divide by lambda, so you get in fact a number of wavelengths in your optical path, so you get this equation. So from that you can find your wavelengths with an index m here, so because it depends on that number m, by this formula. And you just try several m's and look for which wavelengths between 700 and 300 you have constructive interference. Okay, so for destructive, you take again this phi, and now you say it should be equal to m plus a half to pi. So again, our optical path will be equal to half a wavelength multiplied by m this time. So you will get this. And you get. So here, just notice that if you take that minus half here, you get m plus 1. But what is important is m element of z, so if you replace m plus 1 by n plus whatever, it will also be the same as m. Okay, so you can leave n plus 1, it's okay, but you can also replace m plus 1 by m. Okay, so in that case you find this, and you also plug some m numbers and check for which wavelengths between 700 and 300 you have a destructive interference. And that's it. Okay, so this problem is actually I invented this problem. It's not from any books. It is intended to let you think, because all the problems in the books are just standard things. They are all the same. You just change the situation. So here, let's see. You have a student, so you, for example, wants to set up a beam of light because your professor asked you to set a beam of light with the following characteristics. You want the wavelength to be 600 nanometer. You want the power to be 0.3 watt. Linearly polarized vertically. Area of the beam, cross section, you want it to be 0.5 centimeter squared. Spot shape not important. So, okay, it could be a circular or whatever shape, it's not important. And you have all of this in your toolbox. Some lamp emitting a parallel beam, so that's good. Area is 2 square centimeters, so it's bigger than that, but okay, we can see what we can do. Non-polarized, so we will have to polarize that. 600 nanometers, so that's good. This is already fulfilled. With a power of 8 watts. So 8 watts, we want 0.3 watts, so we can maybe try to lower that down. We have polarizers, 5 pieces, wonderful. So we can polarize the light and maybe play with the power. Metal plates having a hole of area 1 square centimeter in it, 5 pieces. So with that we can change the area of the spot. Okay, and enough holders, okay, to hold everything. All right, so we take that lamp, put it here. We have 8 watts with 2 square centimeters, so that's in fact an intensity of 4 watts per square centimeter. Okay, 8 divided by 2. And it's okay, so first let's transform that area of 2 centimeters square by. To 0.5 square centimeter. Okay, so we use one plate, we put it in the beam. So after the plate, we have 1 square centimeter. Here, however, so the power will change. The intensity is still the same because it is a per square centimeter. So now we still have 4 watts per square centimeter, but the power, which is the intensity by the area, is now 4 watts. Okay, so we have 1 square centimeter, we want 0.5, so we put another plate such that it lets through only half of the beam. Okay, the shape is not important, so it's not important. It will be a kind of moon shape, probably. It doesn't matter. So here we put it here such that now our beam is 0.5 square centimeter here. So now here we have the intensity is the same. It's 4 watt per square centimeter. And your power is now 4 multiplied by 0.5 square centimeter. So that's 2 watts. Okay, 2 watts. So this is okay now. That is okay, but we want 0.3 watt and we have 2 watts. And it's still unpolarized. Okay, so let's just polarize it. We put a polarizer. Polarizer, okay, so now it's polarized. And as you know, from unpolarized to polarized, you lose 1/2 of your intensity. So now the intensity is 2 watts per square centimeter. Okay, and also your power will also drop by a factor of 2, so it will be 1 watt. Okay, so now we have everything except for the power. We have 1 watt and we want 0.3 watts. But, okay, you are intelligent, you know that if we can still use another polarizer, because we can change the intensity with the polarizer. Okay. For example, if this is I3 and this is I4 intensity, I4 equals I3 cos squared theta, theta being the angle between the two polarizers. Okay, so in fact, let's do that. So I is in fact pi over divided by by A, but the A is the same between the two, so it's the same as so it's P4 equal P3 cos squared theta. And P4, so we can find theta using this, so square root of P4 divided by P3. P3 is 1 watt, okay, and P4 is what we want, 0.3 watts. Therefore, we find that our angle must be 56.8 degrees. Okay, that's it. So if we want, of course, that polarization to be vertical, so you just change that one, this the angle of that one, such as that you have an angle of 56.8 between the two. All right.